thank y'all all for being here today for our first task force meeting in the new year. And I want to go ahead and ask my co-chairmen if they have anything that they would like to say.
First of all, good evening and welcome. We're reading in my tradition in Judaism now the story of the splitting of the Red Sea and how the Israelites went through. And it's interesting because there is a story in Midrash that relates to all of us. When the Israelites were standing at the edge of the Red Sea and it wasn't opening, a man named Nachshon started to walk into the water and the water did not part. He walked up to his hip and it did not part. He walked up to his chest and it did not part, but he kept going with belief and in faith. And when it ended up right under his nose, when he thought he would drown, the sea parted and the Israelites were able to go through. I say this because at times it would seem that we too as a society are looking in front of us and not seeing a clear path of how to get through. We're looking at us and, you know, we're facing a huge task here. And some people are saying, oh, you won't be able to do it. How are you going to be able to help solve this problem? But I look back towards my faith tradition, I look back towards a story that's saying if we keep believing not only in our mission and in our task, but in each and every one of us together as individuals, as a community, as friends, and as a task force, I believe that together we will be able to make the sea of inequity split, so all of us, both in Fort Worth and around, will be able to walk through as equal partners. So I thank you for being part of that.
Bob?
I can't follow that. Hey, I'm just going to follow. Hey.
Ditto.
Amen.
All right, good. Okay. Well, again, thank you all for being here. Now, we've had a lot of community conversations over the last quarter of last year, but we still have some more to do. But our committee work is getting ready to get started, and some committees have already met, and some will be meeting shortly. So, we're listening and learning, and now we're going to do our due diligence and start looking at what we need to do to make our recommendations. So, at this time, I want to go to line three for approval of minutes. Has everyone had a chance to review the minutes? Got a motion?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Ayes have it. Now the next thing is discussion about the redistricting process. As you all know, we talked a little bit about this at our last meeting, and we have had some other conversations, the co-chairs. We've also had a meeting with the mayor, and one of the things that we're going to look at doing is we will be putting forth a recommendation for the pre-council meeting on May the 1st. There's some research that we still need to do in looking at what other cities have done. Austin was one of the examples utilized at our last meetings, but we have found out that there are some other cities that have done some similar work in what they've done to redistricting, putting citizen committees together and so forth. So we do want to do a little bit more research so that the recommendation that we put forward would encompass some of those best practices utilized so that we can also try to see what fits for Fort Worth. I do want to ask Charles, since he was at the meeting with us with the mayor last week, if he'd like to contribute any comments to that.
I think it was a good meeting. I think she was actually more up to speed on the Austin approach than I knew going in. And I subsequently, at the meeting, we found out that the city secretary has done some research on these other cities that have maybe not gone as fully independent as the Austin model, but kind of a hybrid between an independent commission and the city council. So we want to take a look at those and then come back to the meeting and maybe make a recommendation.
Bob Ray, Rabbi Blue, do you have anything that you'd like to add?
No.
I do. What was the purpose of even talking to the mayor about this?
We just wanted to brief her on that we will be looking to make a recommendation on the redistricting process that we would like for the city maybe to take with the next, because we've got two new council seats that will be coming up. You know, I think they take seat 23. And so we want to be able to be proactive in looking at what processes can we do differently so that we can maybe have better representation.
Did you meet with the whole city council?
No, just the mayor.
And Corey, I know where you're going, because that was one of my main questions when we had a suggestion to meet with the mayor about this. The purpose was not for the mayor to tell us what she wanted or what she expected or what we ought to do. And as I said in our previous meeting with the committee chairs a few minutes ago, our job on this task force and the committees, your job is not to anticipate what somebody may or may not want and decide that we should or should not do something. We should do what we think ought to be done for this city. Now, whether or not the mayor and the city council accept it, it's on them. And we can still lobby for what we think is right. But as I think we said at the very beginning, we do not want the mayor or the city council telling this group what we ought to do, except bring them recommendations. And I think that was made clear at this meeting the other day.
Very clear. And she already expected us to have some recommendation. There was nothing was a surprise to her at all. Okay. Any questions? All right. Next thing on the agenda is an update on public engagement. Michelle and Estrus.
Ladies first.
Okay. We had our first of our additional meetings, which we're calling Continuing the Conversation. We had Thursday night. It was a lower turnout than I had hoped for, and Arturo was there, so he could speak to the evening. But even though it was a small group, I believe that the conversation was very good, and that the people who attended seemed to get a lot out of it and were actually saying that they were going to tell others about it. So I'm going to pass them around. We're doing everything we can think of to spread the word, but if you all could help, and I know I sent an email, if there's anything that you all can do to help spread the word, it would be most appreciated. And so this is just a little sheet on some ways that each one of the task force members can help us when it comes to telling people about the meetings and encouraging people to come and participate in the process. So we have our next meeting on Thursday. I have flyers outside. We've sent copies of the flyer to all of our community centers and all of our libraries, so they'll have them out for residents that happen to come in. We also are doing a lot of electronically pushing, and for those of you on Facebook, I would encourage you to like the page. The more likes and the more shares, the higher our visibility gets on Facebook, so that all helps. And we're actually, something we rarely do in the city, we're actually doing paid boosts on Facebook so that more people will see it. We did that for the first meeting. The first meeting was going to be predominantly in Spanish, and so we actually did a target Facebook promotion for people who are dominant Spanish-speaking adults living in Fort Worth, and we reached about 1,200 people through that paid post, but still had some challenges in getting some people to attend. So I'm open to any suggestions and ideas you all might have on how we can spread the word.
Can you guys get those posted now that we're going to the neighborhoods and the community centers into Nextdoor? I know you guys do on Nextdoor.
They are on Nextdoor.
Okay, yes. I haven't seen mine on there yet, but I've actively made it on Nextdoor. And then the other thing, as task force members, a lot of you guys are in some private neighborhood community groups. So you guys can be sharing these events in there as well, because I know that you have to actually be a member of some of those private groups to actually share information into those, especially those neighborhood and HOA groups.
Yeah, we share it on Facebook. The city has Facebook, Twitter, and Nextdoor accounts, and so we're sharing it that way electronically. We also do a community engagement newsletter that goes to all neighborhood leaders every week, and the meetings are in there. We've tagged the meetings on Facebook for the location, so it will show up on those libraries and community center Facebook pages if anybody goes for information on those pages. So hopefully we'll reach some new people.
I know it popped up on my Facebook 3 times today, and I should.
And to compliment Michelle's update, we said from the beginning that this is about listening, and so these series are designed a little differently in a very significant way in response to feedback that you gave about the structure of it. So these are one and done. Well, that didn't sound exactly right. They're one-time structure. Now, they will keep talking, but these conversations aren't part of a series. They're still 2 hours out of respect of people's busy schedules. We open it up. We started with some basic core structured questions, and there's ample space for them to add whatever other points, perspectives, questions they might have. And this is shifting more so toward ideas for solutions, recommendations for solutions, getting their voice in that direction. These are small groups, but a little bit larger small groups, and more of a modified town hall meeting. So each of the groups will have opportunities to engage and report out to all the others. They won't be tasked with writing down the feedback. We'll have city staff that will be capturing that high-level feedback to bring to the next level. So these have been streamlined without compromising the voice of our neighbors.
And I just want to say, too, that I mentioned Michelle, an email. Small size, I mean, while we want as many people as possible to come, if you have great conversation with 8 people and we get that feedback, I'm satisfied. The fact that we have 14 of these conversations going on, plus we're going to have another town hall meeting, it shows that we're doing what we said we're going to do. We're going to reach out to this community. And what you said we ought to do is to engage more citywide. So that's happening with these 14 other conversations. And if we get if 3 or more gather in my name, not my name, but somebody, it's all good. I mean, so I'm satisfied with that if we're getting good response.
Yeah, quality versus quantity. So.
Right.
Good. Also, the citywide town hall meeting, we have put in a request with TCC for their facility, because that was the recommendation from the task force for location. We gave them an option of some dates in March, and we're still waiting to hear back from them. It goes to a central scheduling location, and they just have not gotten back with us yet. But as soon as I have that information, I'll send that out to everybody.
And this would be the South Campus, correct?
Yes.
Any questions?
Is there another meeting that's directed towards Hispanic Spanish speaking?
We can. And
there's going to be a meeting in Diamond Hill, the Diamond Hill Clinic.
We talked about maybe using the Diamond Hill as another opportunity to do a big outreach. So what we did is the facilitator that we had at that meeting was able to facilitate in Spanish or English. So I can get with Estrus to see if we can have that same capability at the Diamond Hill meeting.
Richard Gonzalez.
And we have 4 others. In addition to Richard, that are able to do Spanish.
Pedro, any other comments? Okay, committee reports. We're moving along. Criminal justice, Todd.
Yes, the criminal justice committee. We had the opportunity to meet last week. I think it was our first meeting. We had a lot of good conversation, a lot of good ideas to move forward. Some of the issues I think we're going to be focusing on moving forward, and this is not a complete list, but initial issues that we kind of identified early on is the officer training regarding the cultural diversity and the leadership, police interaction with at-risk youth, the field training of new officers and how that's made up, and the officers' experience, gender, race, and other makeup of those field training officers. Community engagement, which we consist of how the police department is interacting with the community, the makeup of various police advisory committees and other Fort Worth PD citizen committees, and also exploring the creation of a citizen review form is something that one of the issues that we're going to be trying to address. And also looking at and identifying the officer disciplinary process and guidelines. Some of the subject matter experts that we plan on meeting with are the deputy chief over training division, the procedural justice trainer, and various law enforcement officers within Fort Worth PD. We've even thrown out the possibility of having our own individual community conversations in various communities to kind of gauge and see what communities feel about their neighborhood policing, their police officers, or their interaction with police officers. We've requested data breaking down the arrests by division, by types of arrests, by ethnicity, by gender, and by age as well. And we went back to request additional information to extrapolate the arrests of juveniles and what type of arrests and traffic statistics as well. Corey Walters, feel free to if I'm missing anything.
Corey may have something. I don't think you missed a thing.
And we have our next meeting planned for February 12th, where Chief Krause, he's going to be providing us additional information that we've requested to review. And we have our hands full, but we know that we're going to be able to get it done and hope to bring back something to the committee that we feel that the city council and the city would like.
Thank you,
Todd. And if I may add, some things that we hope to come up with that may be something that we could put into action pretty soon rather than later.
Good. Charles, economic development?
Yes. We had our initial meeting last Wednesday. In addition to three other committee members, we were also joined by Sultan Cole, who's the chairman of the Fort Worth Metropolitan Black Chamber of Commerce. I had reached out to Dee Jennings, the president of the Black Chamber, and John Hernandez, although didn't give John very much time, but he is interested in being involved. Also, I spoke to Reginald Gates, who's the TCC now, but his background is such that he would be a great resource for our community. Of course, Robert was there providing great expertise. What I told the committee I was looking for, what I thought our purpose was to be able to make some meaningful recommendations to the city council regarding improved policies or practices related to expanding economic opportunities for disadvantaged businesses and communities in Fort Worth. And that the scope of what we were looking at, which was looking at our economic incentives policies, the whole range, tax abatements to TIFs to everything, and also our minority business enterprise program, any changes in policies and practices there. We were able to get some good up-to-the-minute information from Robert on changes that had already been made, changes that were being looked at, and we'll have to wait for the minutes to come out, but we actually had some recommendations come up that we think are actionable pretty quickly that hopefully at our next meeting, which will be the 31st next week, that we can get the committee to go on record. So I think we're off to a good start.
Let me know if John Jacinto in his office would also be a good person to bring up.
Okay.
All right. Education, Bob and Robert. Bob. He's looking at you, Bob.
Okay. So, Robert and I have met. We have started to meet with subject matter experts. We've met with Erica Beltran from Leadership ISD, who is on the State Board of Education. We've got a meeting set up with Sherry Breed, Chief of Equity and Excellence with Fort Worth ISD. And we have our first full committee meeting date set, which we will share with our fellow committee members here in a moment on Friday, the 2nd of February. I think right now our objective is to listen to our subject matter experts, ask a lot of questions, get from them as much of their expertise and research as we can before we formulate a plan of action. I think ultimately it's about what can we do as far as recommendations to make sure that there are equal opportunities for our students across the board, regardless of where they live in the city.
Any questions on education? Health, Yolanda.
We have already, the Health Committee, we've already had our first meeting. It was a very productive meeting. And in that, we had a collective conversation and really just discussed where we would start with the whole topic of health, because it was a pretty broad. So we determined that we would just look at access to health. And we were talking about reaching the basics of just reaching basic health care, transportation. But even after this committee meeting, we think we might rethink that a little bit. I'll share with the committee about that later. But access to healthy and nutritious foods, and access to parks and recreation. So when we're looking at health, we did have lots of reports on, you know, the disparities and the percentages of obesity rates in certain zip codes. So we didn't want to get necessarily overwhelmed with that because we already had that data. We want to look at, you know, why do those numbers look like that? And we kind of narrowed it down through conversation. It was just access. So that's where we want to place our focus. We have the reports, and we do have some publications and websites and databases that we will refer to, and we've also identified our subject matter experts and we'll begin interviewing. Again, I mentioned we did have our first meeting week before last, and we have our next meeting on Thursday, and Ann Sawyer Caldwell will be there for the first interview of our SMEs.
Thank you, Yolanda. Any questions? All right, housing, Katie.
I'm asking Yolanda also to step in anytime. During this report, we've had two meetings of our committee. We have identified many, many experts that getting arms around the huge topic of housing has been a challenge. We have heard a report on the assessment of affordable housing. Affordable housing is the issue that was raised up out of the committee, community meetings, that and transportation bleed into one another. And how can you incentivize developers around affordable housing in a housing market like we have right now? A seller's market when they don't need to pay attention to all this. They don't need help. And how do you spread the goodies of economic development throughout all classes of people in the city? I mean, a rising tide may raise all boats, but it certainly doesn't put people in housing equally. We heard a report because several people had mentioned it to us, so we thought we'd find out about the tiny houses idea that is being floated out, and in fact is being done. They're spending $8 million plus on the development of tiny houses in Dallas. So we have heard about the pros and cons of that, which are many. Putting a small house in an urban environment raises a whole lot of issues. Not the least of which is if you put them in all a little village together, are you just recreating segregation of formerly homeless people? So the more we learn, the more we know we don't know. So we're continuing to bring in the housing experts. We have another meeting scheduled, the exact date of which I don't have in my head at the moment. But we'll be meeting two times a month at least as we go forward, because right now we're just learning. Learning about how state laws impact what cities can do as the state legislature increasingly tries to control what cities are able to do and not do. So it's becoming increasingly clear to me, if not other committee members, that our suggestions will impact not only policy suggestions on the city level, but at the state level as well, inevitably. I don't know how we will avoid doing that. So we're looking at dealing with state, county, and city level, I suspect. Do you have anything you want to add to this?
I wasn't able to attend the last meeting, the first meeting. I think Katie summed up, it's a big issue, and it's where do you start, but at the same time, a lot of it does boil down to the accessibility of affordable housing, and you know, not just from what a lot of folks think of, but you know, a recent college grad being able to find somewhere to live, a family, you know, working families be able to find somewhere to live that's convenient to work, and then where does that work take them? As a, you know, do they have to be dependent on cars? And if something happens to their cars, then what? You know, so it's that whole ripple effect. And so it's where do you start and stop? I think that you know, looking at things a little differently than we've looked at before, I think is one of the things that is really going to push us, you know, because we have zoning laws and you know, master plans and all those kinds of things. So how does all that work together? And then so you don't also have the kind of stigma of not in my backyard, you know, if you bring something new to the table. So.
And the Housing Connection report that we heard at this last meeting was very useful to in their work in helping people navigate financial institutions and learning what subsidies might be available for them, particularly for people that are in like the 50 to 60% of the poverty level that are paying enough rent in an apartment nowadays that they could move into a house if they could navigate. And people who've never owned a home before, whose family never owned a home, getting them into a house for the first time. Discovering other issues of having a proved up deed for a family that has inhabited a home generation after generation after generation, and trying to track that clear deed back so that if they have an opportunity to sell it or to need to apply for a subsidy, can they prove they own that home, even though their great grandmother owned that home? And then their grandmother, and then their mother. There are whole levels of those issues. And I think at some time, Charles, maybe the Housing Committee and the Economic Development Committee might meet together. Because, I mean, we could meet together with all of you, quite frankly, particularly transportation. But I'm thinking economic development, maybe as we get further down the road, it might be useful for our groups to meet together.
I agree.
That sounds good. Remind me to tell you about a program called Mount Pleasant afterwards, okay? Any questions of housing? Transportation, Nima's not here. Do we have somebody that can give his report?
We can try.
You were all leaving out the rest of us here.
So, actually, if you can help get the issues, because I don't think I can remember a couple of them, but we met last Tuesday, at the city, which is an important point because the city council meeting was canceled, but we were trying to be there, so that we had some drama. We mainly heard, of course, from the Transportation Authority, and you know, I have listened to transportation speeches, several of us have, you know, for many years, but we got more details in this small group than we have for years. And one, I think the main thing we heard was the flexibility and the fact that they have been given and charged with being more flexible on how they talk to employers, how they seek answers, how they work with some of our smaller cities that actually, you know, the T goes through to get to, you know, Richmar, and offering them a different way to fund some of that than in the past. If they had gone to their city council, they would have just said, no, we cannot pay half cent tax. But if you said, can we pay for, you know, the, what do you call them, the
shelters.
The shelters and other things and signage and all that, it has a whole different sound to it, and they've been able to do that. And was it River Oaks that took them off on that?
there also, there was a lot of conversation about increased access and, of course, safety. And I think everybody hit them up on better lightage and signage. And that's actually what they changed in their budget for this year, was some of those kinds of things that we talked about. You know, and again, now I'm putting on my workforce hat. You know, one of the things that we talked about, of course, was, you know, all the jobs being in Alliance, and yet it stops, kind of actually stops at our career center and TCC, but I can't get them to the employers up there. We talked about maybe working with Uber and Lyft and seeing some ways that I know others have when the bus isn't there, are there other ways that we can get transportation to those in need? With all these different ideas and solutions, one of the things at first it started out with, okay, we need the city to help us promote some of these things. And in the end, we talked about that there needs to be a whole education campaign that would be much more comprehensive than just putting it on the city's back. You know, you need some more lunch and learn, some real opportunities for people to learn different ways to access the Transportation Authority. And that was one of the issues we actually put out. Y'all remember what the others were?
Do you have your notes? I found mine.
So she covered
okay. It'll probably trigger your brain. So Kate Beck was really good about getting this. Arturo was really good about how does it all tie back to the race of culture task force, and Kate was really good at getting us and trying to zone us in. So we are focusing on funding opportunities and what does that look like. So again, kind of as Judy mentioned, the different structures and models with the different partner cities. As you look at the TEAS map and where the gaps are, the service and things, but also where ways to approach those other smaller municipalities to get more buy-in that then spreads some of the wealth around and can increase overall service. Education awareness, we talked a lot about that, because so many of us, you know, like myself, we didn't grow up taking public transportation. So yes, when I go to New York City or Washington DC or other cities, you have to navigate it. But here you can get away from having to do it. So as a way to increase ridership and demand and through education. And then we also wanted to talk, again, kind of as Katie was mentioning, overlaying with maybe Charles's group around the new economic development plan and strategy and the key areas there to make sure that there's some good overlap. But, you know, we talked about how Charles's presentation a few meetings back overlaid education, poverty, race, and all those things. So not reinventing the wheel, but how do these things also overlay with those so that we can drive our recommendations.
Jeff Davis has his group, Tarrant.
He was mentioned as a
Transit
resource.
Alliance.
Yeah.
Yes. You know, so he may be one to get in touch, because I know they're going to be partnering with TCC and TCU on education outreach and enhancing the community's awareness.
He's on our list too.
Rose, now that you mentioned, I attended that meeting last week at TCU that was the Tarrant Transit Alliance.
Uh-huh.
And so it was interesting, several city council members attended. Former Mayor Barr, Chamber of Commerce folks were there. So the attempt of this group, as I understand it, is to create kind of a coalition of advocacy entities to push for transit improvements. And, you know, my training is you always try to figure out where the money's going to come from. So the Transportation Authority has a great plan. Nobody's funded it. And that's kind of where they're at. So the advocacy push is to let's find the money, let's develop the strategies to implement this. But
right.
It does, I think so many of what elements there relate to us, the transit-dependent population, the equity and access and all that stuff. So I think having a robust, equitable transportation system is vital. That's obviously why we have a committee that's focused on that as well. So just something to be mindful of and to watch.
Right. I'm glad you attended that. I had a meeting with Jeff, but I got sick and had to cancel it. So we're scheduling now, so.
And we're working on our next meeting. Our office is coordinating with the city to see if we could have them in our office, because it looks easier to get to than actually City Hall. In and out of.
In and out, yeah. Understand. Okay. Any questions on Transportation Committee?
I just wanted to apologize for calling Jennifer Yolanda. I realize Yolanda's name tag was right in my eyes. I'm sorry, it's been a long day. I'm sorry.
I understand. I'm honored to call, if you call me Yolanda. Fantastic.
Anyway, Brandon.
Don't worry.
Don't worry. As you've heard, there's still a lot of work that needs to be done. And as you all are aware, we were tasked to make a recommendation in August of this year. When we spoke with the mayor last week, we did talk to her about coming up, coming to pre-council on May 1st, as I mentioned earlier, and also giving them a preliminary of where we're at and some of the things that we've discovered, but some of the things that we may still need to investigate. Before we can really come out with some recommendations. So we did ask her also that we may ask for some extra time, where maybe we go on until the end of the year instead of in August, based on where we're at come April. So we will keep you all informed of that, but it's also going to be based on all the research that we get between now and April. But we will be making a preliminary presentation to them on May the 1st. You know, that will also include the redistricting issue. So that will be there as well. So just to let y'all know where we're at and what we're thinking. Because there is a lot to cover, as you've all heard, all the different committees and the things that they're going to be researching and so forth. We just want to make sure that we do our due diligence to get it right the first time. All right. As you'll note, our future meetings are on Monday, February the 19th here. You all have meetings in between. And I will say Angie and Michelle have been very great about sending us the calendar invites of all the meetings that are going on. So if you can attend them, great. If you can't, at least you know that they're happening, okay? And Coach Church, do you have any closing remarks?
I'd just like to say, I mean, it's obvious that you're already working hard and that the real work is going to happen in these committees. So we're looking forward to seeing what you come up with in terms of recommendations. And for all the people who are wondering, is this thing really happening? Is it really working? I think we can put out the word, yes, it is happening. It is working. We don't know how well it's going to work until we actually come up with recommendations. But I'm very pleased with where we are. As one who was doubtful, even cynical at this whole prospect, I'm feeling pretty good right now, based on the work that I've heard that you're already doing. So I'm proud of this.
Okay. I do want to say thank you to Bob Ray and to Michelle and Angie, I think, for helping us write that op-ed piece that we all distributed to you all. And you saw that it was in the paper as well. So please help me thank them for writing that.
No, I was going to thank him as well, because I didn't think he was going to thank himself or the others, but it was a beautiful piece. And I just want to not only second and say thank you, but I just want to remind ourselves, we have a large task force, we have subcommittees, but in essence, the most important committee is the committee of one, the committee of ourselves, because if we live what we're trying to bring about, then we can be a task force every moment we meet someone else. And if we're able to be a task force every time we meet someone else, then maybe that person will become a task force person themselves. Because it's not really what we preach, it's how we live. And if we can do that, if we can leave here living what we're preaching, I have no doubt that any person we meet will eventually go in the same direction.
Well, with that, I just like to say thank you all for being here. This is our first meeting of the year. For many others to come and follow, and we appreciate your time and commitment. And on that op-ed piece, I will let you know that we will be setting up a meeting to meet with the editorial board so that we can keep them in the loop of what we are doing in our process and what status we have, and we'll be looking at that probably sometime in April. Okay? But thank you all again, and we're adjourned.